Please, Mr. Asbestas, Mr. Atkinson, Mr. Georgamlis, and Mr. Komodromou and Dr. Kicker to join us. Thank you very much. Well, until we have our panelists settled down, I'm serving the shipping industry from a leader in ship recycling, the Daido Shipping Company. And I firstly met Dr. Stopford when I was reading his textbook back at MIT as a graduate student. And I didn't expect myself to become a lecturer at the Hellenic Management Center of the Institute Charter of Shipbrokers as a lecturer, teaching maritime economics. So the time is flying very fast. Let me introduce our panelists who will present to you the digital disruption in the shipping business. So we might be the only engineers here in today's conference, and the rest of you might be in the banking sector or ship owners. So I have Vangelis Advetstas, who's a distribution account manager, cloud, and information of technology lead of Cisco Greece, who has a background in computer engineering. Mr. Greg Atkinson, who actually is the director and chief technology officer of Eco Marine Power Company and managing director of Ahori Capital, who has a background in electronic engineering. Mr. Georgamlis, who is the chief executive officer of Prisma Electronics, who has a background in electrical engineering, so too many engineers tonight. Mr. Komodromos, who is the co-founder and chief executive officer of Vesselbot, who didn't reveal his academic background. And the only lady that we have today as a member of the panel in the whole conference, Dr. Kirsi Tika, who has an excellent background in naval architecture. So before we start and discuss about the digital disruption, I'll share a personal story with you. I have a 13-year-old son, so 2 or 3 years ago, I sent several emails to my colleagues, both in academia and the industry, to start preparing his professional plan. And I asked, how business will be in the next 50 years, so, where he has to find himself after 50 years in order to be at a position to deliver and perform. And 9 out of 10 responded about software, computers, and computer science. So that's the only answer I got, no social science, no anything. So the other thing that I have seen is the more events that I'm participating in the shipping industry and technological part, always I see fewer and fewer women. So Kirsi, how do you think, since you are the only lady here, we can tackle both issues and have more women on board the shipping and technological vehicle while tackling this disruption?
I think we need a pipeline. I think it's a question of pipeline. So when I studied, which is a long time ago, there were very few women studying mechanical engineering, which is what I studied first, and then naval architecture later on. There are a lot more women now studying engineering, which makes me very optimistic that there will be, in the future, there will be more people in a panel that are women. I did. I am part of a UK task force on women in maritime, and in fact just participated in a meeting yesterday that is going to tackle this particular issue in the UK because the government in the UK is very interested in bringing more people, and maybe there will be more need for this type of activity in countries. I think the reason why do we want to have more women, apart from that I think women are usually very good, but apart from that, I think we need to attract the best talent to our industry. And if we are only targeting 50% of the talent, we're missing out. So it is very important that we look at the full talent pool. But again, I want to just end on a more optimistic note that the pipeline is getting bigger. And as soon as we have the pipeline filling up, we'll have women here at the panels as well.
Thank you very much. So I'll start with Mr. Asbestas. So Mr. Asbestas is working for Cisco. There is a Greek word named phobos. So digital disruption should be something that creates phobia to the shipping industry, or we have just to take advantage of the business and make our, you know, business more efficient. What do you think?
Yes, hello. I think that it is the same all over the different industries, so the same applies to the maritime industry as well. So I think we need to take advantage of the technology that can actually serve us. The only fear that we can see is the inherent, let's say, resistance to change in both companies and people, and to proceeding with technologies that are a little bit unknown or fuzzy at the moment. So, for example, how can you implement and proceed with an IoT solution when you don't have enough data to analyze and see what is going to be the result of such an investment? But I believe that with more time, as the time passes, this is going to be less and less, let's say, scary for the companies.
Well, it's an approach. Mr. Atkinson, Mr. Asbestas believes that, you know, we should open our doors to technology and become more digital. Since you have such a diverse background, serving from several positions, what is your opinion about this?
Yes, shipping to me is a bit of a strange industry. I started in shipping, but then I went through telecoms and electronics, and I've come back at shipping again. And some of the discussions that we're having in shipping are probably discussions that we had in telecoms probably in the 1990s, you know, about extracting data, managing data. And so I think there's a huge potential for shipping to learn from other industries and not think in a silo. There's a lot to be learnt from aviation. There's a lot to be learnt from robotics. There's a lot to be learnt from production lines in factories, which are, you know, basically automated. And I think we're maybe on that that moment where all these technologies are going to come together, and that we'll be able to learn from other industries and make, you know, really quite rapid improvements in how the ships are managed and basically the performance management across the industry.
Sounds very interesting to me. Let's also hear the view of Mr. Yorgamlis, who's sitting next to Mr. Atkinson. Mr. Yorgamlis have shared some professional insight about how charterers are using their equipment, both hardware and software, to install on board ships from ship owners in order to be able to, you know, track all the data from the ship. And the funny stuff is they have exclusivity term that they don't allow the ship owners to use the same system. So are charterers disrupting the ship owners? What do you think?
Thank you for the introduction and the question. Shipping industry is a complex environment, and also there are different type of interest. So charterers today utilizing their own technology, no matter how correct or not it is, try to improve their profit. From the other side, shipping companies must do something similar in order to stand against any claim and be sufficient to protect their own interest. As mentioned before, today we are entering, today, all of these years, we are entering into an era of a data-driven decisions. And this means that only those that have the right decision can answer questions or claims. So many times we face ship owners asking our helps in order to present to the charterers data regarding good weather or bad weather and negotiate better the charter agreement. So the faster that a shipping company will enter into a position that collect their own data regarding operational, technical, or financial details, the sooner he will be in a position to maximize their own profit or minimize their own operating expenditures. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Although being in the business for almost 25 years, I mean, military and maritime business, every day I have to learn a different term. So I will kindly ask Mr. Komodromos to explain to the audience within a minute or two what artificial intelligence and virtual reality is and how you can convince a ship owner to apply this new digital environment to their business for their benefit, even through your products.
Okay.
Please.
Thank you for hosting us. So how many ship owners are here now? Can I see some hands? 10, 15. Anyway, how many of you are using actually advanced technology into your actual operations today? And I'll answer the question afterwards, and there's something I'm trying to indicate. Advanced technology would mean artificial intelligence, augmented reality, blockchain, big data analytics, whatever. How many? Okay. In other industries, the same question, which are similar industries like aviation, for example, mentioned before, you would get the majority of the organizations actually using, in certain use cases, advanced technologies. So back to the question, and that's where I'm going. Artificial intelligence is the usage of certain algorithms that were produced either internally or by third parties like Google or Facebook or whomever that might be, Microsoft, where you can use a lot of data in order to start managing it, understanding, and taking either prediction, make predictions, forecasts, or make supported decisions at the beginning, or automate the decision-making process. So, for example, I'll give you an example what that might be. If someone might have the opportunity to use the supply and demand data that exists through different sources, would he be able to make more correct commercial decisions in regards to where should I be positioning my vessel, which type of contract should I be getting, which charter should I be using, which direction should my vessel be taking because there's concentration of vessels in a given area or whatever. So in an automated way, not in a speculative way, you learn from data and you use the data to direct you towards a more informed decision in regards to commercial activities, technical activities, in a range of different operations of your shipping company operations.
Okay, sounds fine. We might need a new translator in the future in order to bring, you know, ship owners and the technologies closer than they are. It might be, you know, a language issue. So I think pretty soon all these issues will be resolved. So since it's a shipping finance event, it is not a technological event, it's not a digital ship, there are two major issues that the shipping industry and the shipping business, mainly the ship owners, are facing and will face in the future. So first of all, we have a new building ship, which is going to serve the industry for minimum 20 to 25 years, or 20 years, which is the commercial life of a ship in general. So they have this question about how many digitalization I have to implement and use on board the ship to make this ship as efficient as possible throughout her whole life. And taking this and also going to the bank, they need to convince the, you know, the capital markets, the banks, and the funding entities about providing increased capitals versus to another ship that won't be so much digitalized. So how you can solve, Mr. Asvesas, being on board Cisco, which is, you know, a huge company, and assist the ship owners to make this disruption actually a benefit and not a problem to them?
Yes. First of all, I would like to say that Cisco has a broad network of partners who are specialized in the maritime industry. So they are using Cisco's technologies to serve the maritime customers, so the shipping companies, and they can act as consultants to the shipping companies and help them do, let's say, the exercises needed to understand what are the technologies that will be of benefit to the companies. So it's like having a mechanism feeding data and helping you take the decisions. Of course, you could say that the most efficient ship is the ship that has the latest technology. Okay. Of course, that would not be cost effective, for sure. It's like with every technological asset. So if you go for the latest, the greatest, you pay the more. So you need to find the golden, let's say, so the point where you need to stop, where you need to, or the point where the investment will give you at least the 80% of the maximum benefit you can get. So that's actually a difficult exercise, and those who will dare to do it and invest in that are the ones who are going to benefit from incorporating part of the savings to their profit. As the time passes and the more of these technologies are commoditized and everyone gets it, then the benefit of the cost reduction will be sacrificed to the sake of the competition, of the competitive pricing.
I think that was a pretty solid answer. Let's continue with Mr. Atkinson. So we all have a smartphone nowadays, but I don't really know how much percentage we are using out of this digital technology. It might be usually less than 5%. So we have all this fancy digital stuff, but we don't take advantage of them, and maybe we don't need so many stuff. We don't need all these, you know, applications that we have. And the ship owners, they would like to have this digital transformation and not adaptation, I think, on my view, by paying the minimal cost, because the operating cost of the ship should be reduced and should be this an added value. So do you have any tools, or do you think, you know, the future ship should have embedded several technologies to offer these advantages, but at the level we get, you know, the maximum performance we need, and not just have digital information aboard the ship for nothing?
Yeah, I guess one of the challenges is, especially from engineers, is we tend to overcomplicate things. And really the trick here is to make things as simple as possible. You know, if we keep building digital systems on ships and making the ships very complicated, then actually we're causing another layer of problems, because then you've got to fix this level of complication on the ship, and there may not be the crew members on the ship that can, you know, handle this level of complication. So, you know, my thinking is to try to bring as much back to the cloud as you can, and keep the installation on the ship as simple as possible. So an analogy would be that, you know, basically you just have a pipe and you're just dragging out as much data from the ship as you can in the simplest way you can, and you're doing the processing that data, you know, via the cloud or shore-based computing. And then if you can try to keep the amount of equipment on the ship minimum, then you have an upgrade path. You know, maybe in 5 or 10 years' time, you have to change a couple of boxes, a couple of servers. But the trick, I think, is to keep it very simple on the ship and don't box yourself in. Make sure you've got an upgrade path. Make sure you've got some sort of roadmap, a technology roadmap, and, you know, you have some vision about how you can upgrade it in the future.
Okay, thank you very much. Mr. Yugramlis, I have two questions for you. The first one is, I know you are installing, you know, your products on board the ships, and you provide all this digital information to the ship owners. So what do you think, I mean, how many of this data they are actually using effectively from your point of view? I know you're not in the shipping business as a ship owner, but I'm sure you share the information with clients. And the second question is, how easy is it to open the door in the shipping business to the ship owners and let them talk about, you know, the things you can do? How this is happening through the conferences, through the marketing, because they actually request from you to give them solutions. What is your idea about this?
I think that technology works like the human beings. An engineer, when he starts his career, he is not sufficient enough to handle things. By the years, he has the experience and the ability and the skills to do much more things. The same with the data. The more data that you have, then you have mathematics and you have various procedures that can support better operation. Let me add something for the definition you asked before. We all discuss for expressions like artificial intelligence or machine learning. What this means? Means procedures. For example, for artificial intelligence, means a procedure that acts and responds like a human being. While machine learning is the ability of the machine, for example, imagine an autopilot in the vessel, to adjust its operation according to the weather conditions. So technology is doing big steps, but not there, especially for the environment of the vessel. From the other side, we have seen that if someone starts today, after 6 months, he is in a position to do things in a different manner, and after 3 or 5 years, he will have a different way of approaching its own business in a far more efficient method. Now, regarding the adoption, what we have seen from the time being, by installing such a system inside the vessel, a lot of weird situations appear. First of all, the awareness at headquarters for what's happening on the vessel during the day or the night. Just today, most of the vessels rely just on the Dunnu report and what the captain is reporting. To continue, you already ask for charterers or the weather forecasting agencies that provide forecasts for what the weather it is. But is it accurate enough? Life is complex and the environment of the shipping is much more complex. So at the moment, we try to find ship owners that want to operate in a transparent way, ship owners that want to be early adopters or control far more better their daily operation. I think that it is early, but now the technology is becoming much more mature and this is speeding up. So we expect that in the near future it will be a necessity, especially if the emission trade scheme will impose. And as already mentioned, other industries are suffering for such regulations. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We know that the Greek ship owners, at least, are very adaptive to solutions that are proven. They don't want to make experiments with their ships. They just want to use, you know, sophisticated tools that will provide some output to the shipping business and transporting the commodities. On the other hand, Mr. Komodromos is providing a product to the industry, both in the ship owners and the charterers. It's a platform that, where you can combine several commodities and match charterers with ship owners. So who, in your opinion, are the more adaptable one? You know, the ship owners or the charterers? And also a second question is, what is your opinion about the ship brokers, you know, taking a look at this platform while, you know, doing the disruption in their business too?
Okay, I'll start from the latter. So just to frame it a little bit, because the panel's discussion is digitalization, and digitalization means that as per Gartner, which is a very famous organization publishing different technological trends and provides consulting services, says that digitalization is the way that we are using modern technologies in order to change the way that we produce revenues, we conduct our business, our operations, we market our services, and which are the services that we are providing are also influenced. So the whole business model changes because of digitalization, not digitalization, which is we do digital different operations within the organization. So back to your question about how it is being perceived by the market and ship brokers. Well, we are in a market where we are identifying a gap on how things are being conducted today. We've discussed with both ship owners and charterers and identified that there is a lack of automation and data transparency in regards to the way that we are doing currently our business. So today, this is either being taken as a positive or negative, and certain ship owners and charterers do face it positively and others not. In the end, though, whatever digitalization is bringing a change in the business models. And that's where new initiatives like ours, like VesselBot, are coming into play. And that's how the freight forwarding, for example, market has changed significantly, because companies like Flexport, who now has a valuation of $1 billion and has received funding of $300 million, is changing throughout the whole way of how the freight forwarding business is conducted. So again, digitalization brings differentiation in business models, in the way that we conduct business, in through technology and through these advanced technologies that are being launched lately.
Thank you very much. Okay, let's see this science fiction movie that we live in 2050, and we have this autonomous ship that everybody is discussing, a super digital ship. You can, you know, watch the video from Rolls Royce, etc., all this fancy, crazy stuff that, you know, you only watch in the movie theater. So, Kirsi, let the children of these 15 ship owners that will be the next generation, what type of personnel they will need? So, which people they need to hire in order to continue undisrupted their business and be able to go to the next step? What is your view about future and people, please?
It's going to be a blend of the traditional capabilities as well as some of the new capabilities. I truly believe that we will continue need the skills of master mariners and chief engineers, but they have to be blended with the people who know the networks, understand the data systems, the analytics, and are able to incorporate new technology to shipping. I think the challenge is going to be there are going to be challenges in blending these to experience spaces. There will be a challenge between the human-machine interaction, and there will be a challenge in providing the pipeline for the traditional capabilities. So I do believe that the traditional capabilities will be required, but they need to be supplemented with people from other fields.
Thank you very much. And let's close with a last round of question to our distinguished panelists here. So it's another academic exercise, of course. You know, since I'm teaching maritime economics, so we are all ship owners of a new super digital ship, and each one of us has to be in front of the banker and tell them why our ship will be more effective, smarter than the existing ships that our 15 ship owners here are offering to the market, and why we should get a better financing of our ship. So you have a minute each one, please, to convince our bankers here why you are best compared to the old traditional ships that we actually have. Please. Mr. Zestas.
Okay, it's a quite difficult question for an engineer. So this can be only proven by data. So having implemented technologies that can help you gather the data can help you also justify why this ship is more effective and why this ship is going to be more productive and bring you bigger profits versus any other ship. So this is of course possible only after such a ship has been created and sailed, and you have already data to support it.
Thank you very much, Mr. Atkinson.
Yeah, I mean, I see a huge potential to make ships more energy efficient, which is obviously Eco Marine Power's core focus. For example, just lighting on ship. If you go on a ship, you could walk around and just count the money from the number of lights on a ship that don't even need to be on. And you could have data that and set up algorithms that would turn off lighting when you don't need it. It's very, very simple. Another one would be the power management on a ship. You know, if you're running a generator up and down and it's varying speed, it's not running efficiency. It's not running efficient. But you can use data to schedule when equipment switches on and off so that you keep the load on the generator the same. And I just see a lot of potential and a lot of easy wins to save fuel. And if you're saving fuel, you're saving money.
Thank you very much, Mr. Yorgamblis, about your view about the future optimized better ship.
Bringing together the previous session with this one, I have heard that transparency makes money available. Data means transparency, especially if the data are collected automatically from the systems without interference of the people. So a vessel fully automated with the right systems on board, this is very crucial, means crystal clear operational expenditure, better maintenance, better efficiency, and many more. So the message is clear. Such type of vessel should be financed. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your approach. Mr. Komodromos, please.
Okay, so we heard quite a few times the word risk management. I have a finance background, by the way, so I'm the only one that is not a technology guy here. So understanding what a financial risk and all the other risks involved in the operations, you might argue that using technology, you can either predict and understand the risks that are being imposed by any of the risks involved. Either this is the technology risk, either this is commercial risk, counterparty risk, operational risk. All these risks would be easily detected and predicted with the usage and with the usage of technology and tools that already, by the way, exist outside in the market, and you could be utilizing them today. So we are not speaking about science fiction and things that are coming. These are actual technologies that have been tested, have been already used by a lot of the market stakeholders, and could be used to optimize performance, to optimize commercial activities, to reduce for the dear financiers here their risk and understand the risk. So the technology is there, and it's up to the market to use it and take advantage of it.
Thank you very much. And let's conclude the way we opened our discussion with our lady, please.
So I'm going to focus on the ship itself, not on the commercial operations. And I think it's quite simple where the change can come from. And I think it is the reliability and robustness of the systems. To increase autonomy of the ships, we need to have more reliable and robust ships and systems on board the vessels. And once we have that, and we combine that with preventive and predictive maintenance, we can reduce the out-of-service time. And I think that's where we can really benefit from.
Thank you very much. Time is ringing. I hope you enjoyed the engineer's approach to the digital disruption in shipping business. And it was a warm session. We are at your disposal for any questions you might have, and we hope we were able to answer. So feel free to have a question here from Mr. Gartsos, please. If you can be kind enough to share the microphone here. Thank you. Yes, please.
Question and comments. I think Mr. Atkinson is the only person that probably mentioned cost benefit. Because otherwise, everyone was saying how wonderful everything is. Now, basically, if you can't prove the cost benefit of any gizmo, and I am an engineer and I love all that kind of stuff, if you can't prove it, then your financier is not going to accept it. And basically, you should not be able to do it if your ROI does not justify it from its installation or whatever else. That's number one. The number two is, you mentioned about benefits that you would have when chartering and God knows what. In order to do anything, you need a level playing field of sorts. Now, unfortunately, with all these electronics that we have on our ships, every chartering office in the world knows where the stupid ship is. We don't know where their cargoes are. So basically, you are at a disadvantage as a ship owner with all the electronic gizmos that have been planted on board the ship. And just to make this a little bit more interesting, the reported fixtures represent roughly 15%. Plus or minus a few percentage points over a number of years of all the cargo traded. So that means you don't know where and who has the rest of the cargo. And maybe the unreported fixtures that brokers know about is another 10%. So let's say 75% of where and what the cargo is and who is moving it, you don't know. So if you don't have balanced information, I don't know where you get the advantage for ship owners. I think I'll stop with that. Thank you.
Thank you very much for these two statements that are, you know, welcome. We discussed that about that the ship owners will only use proven technologies. That's, we agree on this statement. With respect to the cost-benefit analysis and about the commodities and the cargoes, you know, I can ask any of my colleagues here on the panel. Mr. Komodromos would like to share his opinion with you, if you don't mind.
Okay, I do understand where you are coming from. So as far as the cost is concerned and the cost-benefit analysis, you're spot on. I don't disagree at all. Bear in mind, though, that given the new ways that these technologies are being introduced, there are cases where you don't pay anything. So you might be even using a technology because the specific business model is structured in such a way that you don't pay anything at all. So one part of your question. On the other side, you might have, you have up to a certain point, right, that you cannot see the full visibility of cargo as per today. Understandable. As I mentioned, through analytics, and we are already doing that in a lot of extent, we source the AIS data, the satellite data that already exist, and we can forecast and predict where the supply and demand are lying at a given time point, time frame. Moreover, we are discussing about the way that we are working today, right? So as far as we are concerned, someone might arguably think, okay, when there is an offering that says, why don't we change the way that we are working today towards a more transparent way on a platform, on a marketplace, which, by the way, marketplaces exist in all other markets apart from ours. Why don't we go to a marketplace approach where all these are listed? Yeah, I don't see why you're... I would disagree with you because it is being currently implemented not by just one, but more, and it is being used by major players in the market. And by major players in the market, I mean major. So it might be a perception, it might be reality in a lot of senses. So why don't you make the move and do take the market towards the direction you want to take? So it's there. It's just up to you to decide whether you want to move towards a direction where you have complete visibility on the cargo or not and stay to the current status quo. No? Why not? I do ask the cargo owners. I talk to the cargo owners directly to the senior management. So I know where they stand. The majority of them do hear the proposition, so it's there.
Yeah, if I could just address some of your points. I mean, I understand what you're saying, and that's one reason our company had to get into data logging is because the only way that we can prove that the fuel saving or the measurement works is we actually have to show them the drop in fuel consumption. So yes, you have to show it. You can't just come up with some, you implement this digital technology, it'll save you money. You have to show it. And regarding sensors, and having a lot of electronic equipment on ships, I started as a technician on ships, and I hate sensors. You hit a wave, 40 sensors go bleeping, you know, and you're running around trying to fault find. So, you know, that's why I said before, it's you can go very easily to the complex side, but what's more of a challenge is to come back to the simple side and keep it simple.
Thank you very much, Greg. We have a question from the gentleman there.
Thank you. My name is John Patignotis from Karaselas. My question is for any one of the panelists. Do you believe that all of these very high-end technology and big data and information in real time can protect the owner from human errors? Thank you.
A very interesting question. Also, the security of the data is another interesting part. If I can add another question to yours, we recently saw Maersk getting a hit of $300 million about shutting down their systems for a few days. So who would like to... Kirsi, please.
So there is one of the benefits of this development projects on autonomous ships is that they are developing technologies that can help, can assist and prevent human error. I'll just give you example on navigational aid, such as the situational awareness that you have different technologies available now to see what's around you without human eye. You can apply object recognition to tell actually what it is that you see, and you have technologies for collision avoidance. And of course, to really have a full benefit from this, we need further development in machine learning and artificial intelligence. But these are already technologies that can be applied, and they can be applied on existing ships as well. You don't have to build a new ship to have this. So I truly believe that these new technologies do offer aids that can prevent human error.
Mr. Yorgamlis, please.
The answer is definitely yes. We have seen many times that, first of all, by the crew knowing that is the information exists also in headquarters, are being much more careful on their operation. Also, the experts that typically located in the headquarters are capable to support better the crew. And second, they are able to prevent or to see the trend that something is not being well maintained or something appears to be in a faulty situation. So from the experience that we already have, this is one of the major elements that someone is getting. Responsibility and the ability to help each other in order to minimize human error, even by ignorance or lack of knowledge.
Hope your question is tackled.
Sorry, can I just say one thing? Yeah, I'm a bit of a dissenting voice, I'm afraid. I think if you want to understand the dangers of too much technology and the decrease in human skills, you could read the two collision accidents reports for the two US naval ships that collided recently, and you will see the over-reliance on technology and the under-reliance on just basic seamanship skills. So yes, I agree that technology can prevent human errors, but it can also, you know, complicate things and cause human errors. So we have to be a little bit, you know, a little bit careful and not underestimate the human skills needed of the crew.
Well, the panelists will be at your disposal after the coffee break that we will have immediately after this session. Excuse me.
Very sadly, Dr. Galanis, we actually have to cancel the coffee break and work straight through, although the coffee is available, so people can just nip out to get some to refresh themselves. I know that I've spoken to Despina and the organizer, and she says next year we might be able to organize some robotics, so some drones or robots can bring us the coffee, designed by, I think, Dr. Tika and Constantina already working on the system for this with their next project. But
let's give an applaud to our panelists for sharing. Thank you very much.